Well, you are in the right place at the right time. This is Wealthy Wednesday, and this is Coach Lynn Richardson, and I am so excited about the topic that we have before us today. We have a very, very special guest whom I am going to announce in just a moment, but before we get to that, I'd like to just rewind just a little bit. We've been talking for this year, for the past couple of weeks, about what we need to do to truly position ourselves to get into a financial harvest. And we talked a little bit about the children of Israel and how because of their disobedience, because of their lack of belief, but actually because of their lack of faith, that they wandered in the wilderness for 40 years, never getting to see the promised land. And so many of us have financial issues that feel like we are wandering in the wilderness. So many of us have financial issues, and it seems like there is absolutely no way out. I mean, our backs are up against the wall. The money is not coming in. The bills are coming too quickly. There are too many days in the month. There's not enough money. All those things. And what do we do? For those of you who join me and for those of you who are already enrolled in Wealth University, we got to understand how we begin to master our money in the wilderness. And we talked about two specific areas where we can get our money back. We talked about getting our money back by adjusting our W-4 so that we are not giving the government an interest-free loan. But we also talked about it has to be coupled with the dual task of mastering the money game, getting your money back, operating your home-based business like a business, and writing off every single business expense imaginable, writing off every dinner, every time you get in the car, all the mileage, all the gas, all the travel, all the entertainment that is business related. And that is one way to begin the process of getting out of the wilderness. But what happens when you've done all that? What happens when you've mastered the money game in that regard? What happens when you have cut back everything? You have cut back your cable bill. You are no longer going to Starbucks. What happens when you have maxed out your W-4? You're getting as much back on your paycheck every 2 weeks. What happens when, yes, you are trying to rebuild or leverage streams of income, but the money just isn't coming in yet? And the bills are all over the place. And I'm trying to figure out, how do I create partnerships? How do I go to the next level? How do I get myself out of a rut? Well, I'm going to introduce someone to you today who helped me when I was in a rut. In fact, she's helped so many people, not just in the Chicagoland area, but across the country. She sits on the board of Russell Simmons Hip Hop Summit Action Network Financial Literacy Advisory Council. She is an attorney. She is a wealth counselor. She believes in helping people understand how to grow, how to create, how to build, but more importantly, how to maintain wealth. So without further ado, I'm going to say good morning to Attorney Deirdre Wood Stokes. Good morning, Attorney Stokes. How are good you this morning?
Good morning, Lynn. I'm doing wonderful. I'm doing absolutely wonderful.
Wonderful, wonderful. And this Wealthy Wednesday goes throughout the day, so I'm going to say good morning, good evening, good afternoon, and all
Thing, good Wednesday.
Yes, happy Wealthy Wednesday. Happy Wealthy Wednesday. So, Deirdre, we've got a short amount of time here, and you know how we do it. We've been working together for many years, impacting lives all over the city of Chicago and all over the world. So I'm just going to get right down to it. You know, there's a lot of folks out there who are struggling. They're struggling with debt. They're struggling with bills. They are struggling. They don't know a way out. A lot of times they feel trapped. They're crying. They can't sleep at night. And it just seems like the entire situation of finances is overwhelming. Just last night in my coaching call, I had the opportunity to speak to some wonderful people who just felt, just in other situations, they felt trapped. And, Deirdre, I believe that there is always a way out. There is always a way. So what do you say to the person who is struggling, who's in a situation, their bills are far more than their income, the debts, the bills are coming from everywhere, they've done everything they can do, they've cut back on everything. You know, I was on the phone, I was on the radio once, and you know how Matt and Perry are, and I said that we have live below our means. And so Perry said, well, what you want me to do, live in the gutter? Because I'm already living on the ground. So what do you do when you are already living below your means, you have cut back on everything, but you still cannot make ends meet?
Well, first and foremost, Lynn, what I tell people to do when they come and see me, and for those people out there that don't know me at all, I just want to tell you I've been practicing for over 15 years. My areas of practice are real estate, estate planning, and bankruptcy. And those are areas in business advising. Those are areas that help people accumulate wealth and preserve wealth. And so people say, well, how does bankruptcy get in that mix? Is that sometimes if we step back and we look at the wealthy, and we see that, oh my gosh, so-and-so, you know, it makes the news, this person filed bankruptcy or this company filed bankruptcy. But then, guess what? That company doesn't miss a beat. You know, United Airlines is still flying. American is still flying. You know, these companies, you know, Donald Trump is still making millions of dollars. So then we forget that. Then we think back, did that person file bankruptcy? And you're like, wow, well, what happened is that a lot of my clients over the years accumulated a lot of wealth. You know, they accumulated real estate investment properties and different things. And then when this economy started taking a nosedive and the real estate property, you know, I had clients that had properties that was actually maintaining their lifestyle, meaning that the income they were getting from those properties was allowing them to actually live almost without having a job. And so they were almost out of the rat race. But what happened is that a lot of times their tenants lost their job. So guess what? Their tenants weren't able to make their payments. Then what they started doing was saying, oh, my God, before they knew it, they were dipping into their savings account. They're pulling out of their 401Ks that they accumulated, they amassed with their companies. They pulled out of their IRAs early and then got penalized for to say, let me save this property. Let me save this property. And what I tell my clients, stop just a second. Stop. When you start using good money for bad debt, and what's a bad debt? It's something that is not amassing you anything at the time. When you start taking good money and throwing it after something that really isn't going to turn around for you at this time, you have to know when to hold and when to fold.
Let me just key in on that point, because this is a very important learning point, Deidre, because I think you know that a lot of times these are emotional decisions for people. And I have witnessed many of your clients who own many pieces of real estate state, and they can come in and they can fold. I remember you telling me the story about the lady, a very prominent business in Flossmoor. No emotion. Okay, Deidre, I'm filing bankruptcy. My cash flow will be down to $500,000. I don't want to go under, so da-da-da-da-da. But Deidre, what about the person who they're in their only home? They don't have 5 or 6 or 7 pieces of real estate, but they're in a home right now that they cannot afford. They are pulling their hair out. The first thing they want to go do is go and get the money out of the 401k to save the home. How do you speak to that person?
Well, to that person, first and foremost, it took you years to build up that 401k. It took you years to build up that IRA. And you may try to convince yourself, I can replace it. But 9 times out of 10, everything that you've done is, you know, it is basically for naught at this point. But if you were to consider bankruptcy, and I'm not saying that bankruptcy is the answer. I'm saying that we have options. I'm saying it should be one of the options that you look at. What a lot of wealthy people will do is before their credit is impacted, they will say, oh, my God, it's about to all fall out. And when they realize that, they'll say, I'm going to go buy something else a little bit cheaper in a down market that is going to be bigger than what I have right now. Or if you've already impacted your credit, you may have to go rent for a little bit, and you probably won't even miss a beat. It probably will be a house the same size, maybe a little bit smaller, because in this market people can't sell either. So you can rent properties at this point. Then you need to look at what are you paying in your credit card debt? How much are you paying? Are you paying the minimum payments? Can you really double and triple up on them? Can you pay them off really legitimately? And like you said, if you're living below your means and you can't, you're throwing good money after something bad because you'll never pay those off. Take a step back, say to yourself, you know what? What if I got rid of all of these credit cards right now? Where would I be? How much money would I be able to save? Would it be better? If I'm paying $2,500 for a mortgage payment and I can't afford it, could I go and find someplace for $1,500? Is that the break I need? Yes, if you start looking. Nothing hurts from looking. You don't have to. It's not giving up. I tell people, start exploring your options. Talk to a realtor. Start going around, seeing what's available. And then when you start looking at your options, that's when God steps right in. That's when things start happening, when you start exploring what your options are.
You know, Deidre, you brought up a very, very good point. And, of course, we talked about the people with multiple real estate properties and they've got businesses and things like that. And then we talked about the homeowner who they just have their one home and they're afraid to lose it. And all too often, unfortunately, we're thinking about Big Mama and Pookie and Ray Ray and everybody because they're used to coming over our house. And so if I move into a smaller house, I'm going to have to explain to them. And, you know, I've been through what Deidre is talking about. I gave up everything. I looked at my options, and for years and years, I was throwing good money at bad money. I was bringing money in, but I was throwing it at debt that never would have gone anywhere. And so in starting over, it also has to be coupled with a mindset change, Deidre, because all too often, Deidre, and I know you'll find this, and I want you to speak to this, because we're talking about being in the wilderness and getting out of the wilderness. Sometimes people will come, and they'll come to you for a consultation, and they will explore options. So bankruptcy may be an option in Chapter 7. Chapter 13 repayment may be an option. Or looking at some of your other debts and doing some other things may be an option. Really, talking to someone like yourself who is a wealth counselor who can help them with the legal side of things. But what happens sometimes, Deidre, is that we get out of the situation, we thank God, we go and tell everybody about the testimony, and then we get right back into the situation. What legal options are there for people who go and get right back in the same situation?
Well, you know what, Lynn, the issue with that is that a Chapter 7, you can only file it every 8 years. You know, after you file a Chapter 7, that's where you can wipe out all your unsecured creditors. That's like your credit card debt and items like that. And you can only do those every 8 years. After you get a discharge in a Chapter 7, you can only do a Chapter 13, the repayment plan, 4 years later. So what I tell my clients, because I'm not just a bankruptcy attorney, I want to see them do better. I tell them, I don't want you to come back to me for another bankruptcy. What I tell them is that I need you to start planning and getting yourself on track. When you have to file bankruptcy, you're required to go through something called a credit counseling course. And that credit counseling course generally requires you to kind of look at your budget and look at things like that. I tell them to get with people like you to incorporate some type of join Wealth University so that they can start changing their habits. It normally takes 30 days to form a new habit. And so if you're doing something for 30 days, if you're writing something down, if you're looking at things, if you're actually saving your receipts like you're telling people to do, it will make you more in tune. And guess what? During the time that you file a bankruptcy, things kind of at a standstill. You can't usually go out and get new credit. You can't go do anything else. So it's usually like a 4 to 6 month period. If you take that 4 to 6 month period to start getting yourself on another track, creating a new habit, working with someone like yourself, Lynn, guess what? By the time you get a discharge in bankruptcy, you will be on the road to some type of recovery. I have emails I get from clients later on. I have an email from a physician who actually was laid off, made hundreds of thousands of dollars. Her and her husband both, he was a real estate broker. He owned a company. That company made hundreds of thousands of dollars every year. And basically, they could not afford where they were living. They gave it all up. She sent me an email, oh my goodness, it feels so good to be free. I am now getting different job offers. She wasn't getting a job offer at all because guess what? Her mind wasn't clear. Nothing was happening. So what I'm telling people that if that happens, don't be down on yourself. What you can do is you can start, you know, working with those companies. You can call them up. You can say, what can I do to settle with it? You know, don't beat yourself up because the past is the past. But you can, but you won't be able to go in and file another bankruptcy right away.
Right. And something else that you speak to, Deidre, it's all about timing. When you talk about the wealthy, you say that the wealthy will forecast their demise. Like they'll see their demise coming 3 months down the road. You know, it's January, and they'll know by the end of the second quarter, I'm not going to have anything because I'm looking at my budget, and I have more money going out than I have coming in. And at the rate that the money is going out, it's going to deplete everything. So I'm going to come to Attorney Deidre right now or someone like an Attorney Deidre and figure out my options. But unfortunately for those of us who are underserved, reserved and poor or just sometimes plain uneducated. And I'm not saying anything disrespectfully against any race, but unfortunately sometimes as African Americans or minorities not having the knowledge, we wait until the bottom falls out. We, by the time we get to the bankruptcy court, broke was 27 stages ago. We are barely hanging on to our sanity. Talk to us, Deidre, just a little bit about what it really means to have courage when it comes to facing your situation and not seeing it as a badge of shame.
Well, first and foremost, we have to realize this is a chapter in our life. It's a page. It's not, it doesn't dictate who we are. Look back on the other mistakes that you've made. Haven't you come past those? So this is not, this is just one point in your life. The biggest part I tell people is that once you've made the decision, it is so freeing. All my clients, when they file it, Lynn, when they say the calls have stopped, I kid you not, it is amazing how people say, oh, I can now think clear. I didn't know those calls were bothering me so much. I didn't know that how much I was, you know, avoiding going home or how much I was avoiding not being available. And people start saying, now I can think clear. Now I can see that there's opportunity. So my motto is less of me and more of God. And so what I have to do is it's not about me. It's all about what do I have to do in order to be a good steward. And if I've been a bad steward and if I haven't done a good job and I can't see any way out of it, this is an option. This is an option that's available to you, so don't beat yourself up. It is not that you don't have to talk this over with your friends, your family, unless they're helping you pay your bills. If they're not helping you pay your bills, they're not writing your mortgage payment out, they're not paying your car note, then that's not somebody to talk to. You need to get with yourself. This needs to be an individual situation and an individual decision because it's only impacting you.
Wow, this has just been a plethora of information, Deidre. There's one additional area that I want you to speak to, and I know as attorneys you guys are going to court. Honey, you're doing all kind of things, and we've got some folks who are pressing one to raise their hand, so we'll try to get to a couple of questions. But just before we get to that, Deidre, I'd like to speak to this other issue because we've been talking about mastering your money in the wilderness. Understanding that you have power, you have control, you can make decisions, and yes, there is a way out. You do have options. And what we have to be willing to realize with when we choose the way out, we have to be willing to deal with the consequences of the way out. See, a lot of times we'll pray, God, help me, and God will show you the way out, but we don't want to go that way because it's so far from where we are used to being. One of the things that people will do when they're experiencing a financial wilderness period in their lives is they try to leverage additional streams of income, Deidre. And sometimes people will call me and they'll say, well, Lynn, I want to start my business, you know, and they don't have a lot of money at that particular time. And I'll tell them, okay, as long as you're not doing nothing like being a doctor or a lawyer, something that you need a license, start your home-based business today. Go get your business cards. Say consultant. You can just put consultant on there. That means you can consult on hair, nails, whatever. Yeah. I mean, event planning, what have you. But a lot of times, they'll go talk to somebody else, Pookie and Ray Ray, somebody told them you got to have this. You are the legal expert. Speak to that. When people want to start their business, yes, you can start at one level, but then you can graduate to another level.
Well, first, I want to go back and just clear something up. I'm not telling everybody that bankruptcy is a cookie cutter. If I had a client that came into me, which I recently did, let's say they only had $4,000 worth of debt, I'll tell that person, start answering the phone. Talk to the people and say, can I send you two payments of $500 and can we settle this? 9 out of 10, that $4,000 debt, don't come pay me $1,500, $2,000 to do a bankruptcy for you. Take that money and settle that $4,000. They will take it generally. So it's not a cookie cutter. So I want to tell people start there. And sometimes in coming to see somebody like me, I will be able to advise you that don't come and spend money with me doing that. You can take this money. Your debt is only $5,000. So I want to say that. Now going to the business person is I'm reading right now, Lynn, Do You by Russell Simmons. And as one of my mini books, because she dogs me out, people, because I do read multiple books at a time. It depends on how I'm feeling at the moment. Sometimes I want to do some self-help. Sometimes I just want to read something that's just going to take my mind away. Well, something he said is that your vision is your vision. And in doing you, he's saying doing you. Nobody else is going to know what you is, only you. Because what happens is God planted something in you to do, and nobody else is going to even understand what that is. So stop getting confirmation from other people. They might be a great friend, but they are never going to have the creative peace that only God put in you. You need to get confirmation from yourself. So we need to stop doubting ourselves. And the reason we doubt ourselves is because we look back on our lives and we say, oh, I'm not good with finances. Oh, I'm not good at this. Stop telling yourself those negative things and start saying, but I do this well. I do this well. Start your business, because Lynn is saying we need tax write-offs. But in order to have the write-offs, you got to bring in some income. So you just can't, like, get a telephone and say, I'm going to have a business. You got to actually get out here and start bringing in a little bit of income so you can write something off. So it's not the time to start talking to people. It's the time to start meditating, to start praying, asking God, what is it that you should be doing, and go forth. And the next time you say something to a friend, it's like, oh, you know what, girl, guess what? I started this business last month, and I got my first client. That's what you should start saying, not going to people for affirmation and confirmation.
Wow. You know, and it's so interesting to me. I had a client yesterday, Deidre, and she said to me, she says, I hear people all the time saying that they hear the voice of God, but when I was a kid, I never got to go to church. My grandmother raised me, and she wouldn't let me come to church because she told me I wouldn't sit still. And so I didn't get to go to church. I mean, literally, these are words we got. And she said, now that I'm an adult, I'm very intimidated. I don't like to go to church because it seems like everybody knows the word. I'm the only one who doesn't know, and so on and so forth. But she spoke specifically to this whole idea of not hearing the voice of God and not knowing what to do. Mm-hmm. And Deidre, I believe that each and every one of us hears
Absolutely.
The voice of God. I think
Absolutely.
That just let
Absolutely.
It get clouded by other voices. And well, and you have been just such a champion. We have watched each other grow,
right.
not just personally, but professionally, but spiritually. And you say something all the time about God winks. Talk to us
yeah.
just a little bit about that before you go.
Well, God winks are things that we call, you know, we call coincidence. Like, oh, it's a coincidence. I was thinking that I was going to start, you know, I was going to probably be a singer. And then all of a sudden I ran into someone that said, hey, would you come see? Or you say, oh, that's a coincidence. No, those are God winks, because he planted the thought in your head. And I had a good friend, Lynn, I told you about, 20 years ago that said this to me. She said, none of us are capable of just having random thoughts in our head. Whenever we have a thought, that's God talking to you. And God talks to you in a voice that's common to you. It may be in your own voice. It's not going to be some heavy voice that's going to scare you and have you going crazy down the street. It's going to be something that's common to you. So when you're saying, oh, you know what, I thought the other day, you didn't think the other day. That was God saying that to you. And so a lot of times what happens is we don't explain that to people, and people think that it's going to be some resounding voice, you know, this heavy, James Earl Jones voice saying, you know, go forth and do this. That's not what's going to happen. It's just the thought that you have, like, maybe I should turn down this street. Then you turn down the street and you see someone and you're like, oh my God. And a God wink, as I was sharing with Lynn, is a book that I just finished reading called When God Winks. And what it is that whenever things we want to call as a coincidence, it's not a coincidence. It's God winking, saying, you know what, girl, you're doing what I told you to do. You know, Leah just had a powerful, you know, women's retreat, and there were things that just were favorable for her. Everything she asked for, she got. And I said, you know what, those are God winks, Lynn. Every time you asked the management for something, they gave it to you. That was God saying, hey, girl, you're doing what you're supposed to do. Hey, you're doing what you're supposed to do. And you pull in somewhere, you're running late, and you get a parking space, and you're like, oh, my goodness, any other day I wouldn't have got there. It's because God's saying you're doing what you're supposed to do. So stop calling coincidences coincidence. They're actually God winks affirming what you're doing.
On that note, Attorney Deirdre Wood Stokes, I am just so delighted that we have had the opportunity to have this Wealthy Wednesday with you. Just when you think there is no way out, just go step at the Red Sea. God will part the Red Sea on your behalf, and that is not a coincidence. That is a huge God wink. There are so many of you out there who are trying to figure out, what is my next step? What am I going to do? I've got money coming in, but it's coming into a bottomless cup. Every time I pour it in, it's going out the other side. Guess what? Stand in your power. No longer be afraid. The Bible tells us that God gives us the spirit of power, of love, and a sound mind. And guess what? Where there is fear, there is no faith. So have faith. Take the next step. Do what you know you are supposed to do. Listen to the voice of God. Stand firm in your decisions. Move forward. Explore. Even when you are in the wilderness, that is the time for God to show you to himself. You know, I tell people all the time, you don't know that God is all you have until he is the only one who's left standing there with you. So thank you for this Wealthy Wednesday. If you are interested in a free lecture for Wealth University, please email me, coach@lynnrichardson.com. If you are interested in connecting with Attorney Deirdre Wood Stokes or any of the great coaches on my team, please email me, coach@lynnrichardson.com. If you are interested in life coaching, financial coaching, or getting your breakthrough, don't hesitate to text me, 708-243-7925. 708-243-7925. Thank you so much, Attorney Deirdre. God bless you
Thank
all.
You,
I can't wait to share another Wealthy Wednesday with you. Bye-bye.